The Eternal Repose video series is a controversial topic subject to conjecture and debate. The opinions shared in these episodes are not the official doctrines of the Christian Church, but are my own opinions developed through research and thoughtful contemplation. For those who might think that I am castigating Roman Catholicism, please understand that I was born and raised Roman Catholic. I have received 5 of the 7 sacraments of Catholicism, and I was married in the Roman Catholic Church. The thing that has changed me is that I had an encounter with Jesus Christ and found the truth, and the truth set me free. For nearly 1,000 years, Catholics and Protestants have been engaged in a violent debate concerning the doctrine of purgatory. Armies have marched, cities have burned, and blood has been shed across the European landscape during the religious wars of the 16th and 17th centuries. The powder keg that ignited this fire and blood was the distortion and corruption fostered in the Church of Rome by the doctrines of purgatory and indulgences. Martin Luther strongly castigated the Roman Church and the Pope for their belief in purgatory. Luther referred to purgatory as the third place. He insisted that this invented world had no scriptural foundation in the Bible. The Catholic Encyclopedia defines purgatory as a place or condition of temporal punishment for those who, departing this life in God's grace, are not entirely free from venial faults or have not fully paid the satisfaction due to their transgressions. Along with Luther, let's explore the history of this third place and determine whether the doctrine of this third place is fact or fiction. We often might think that the doctrine of purgatory is unique to Christianity. But there are roots to this doctrine that reach back into ancient antiquity. It is interesting to note that in all religions in which the dead are judged, there is a link between earthly justice and the divine justice administered in the afterlife. Since Roman Catholicism describes purgatory as a temporal punishment used to purify and refine the soul, we look for the thread of purification and justice seen in the afterlife. In ancient India, near the end of the Vedic period in the 6th century BC, it was believed that the dead followed one of 3 paths in the afterlife. Each path begins in fire, since the dead are burned on funeral pyres. The first path is designated for the saved, who have escaped the horrors of continued reincarnation. Upon death, these virtuous souls are escorted to the worlds of the Brahmins to live forever. The second path is for the less than pure, who travel into the smoke of the funeral pyre that leads to the darkness of night. While in the night, the soul is eaten by the gods, then returned to earth to begin a new cycle of reincarnation as a human. The third path is for the unrepentant wicked who basically follow the same path through the smoke, but their end is reincarnation in the form of worms, insects, or animals, and eventually they finally fall into the pit of hell. The issue we glean from the Hindu myth is that death provides three options, with the middle path being a source of continual purification. The ancient Persian religion of Zoroastrianism marginally supports the concept of purgatory. Zoroastrianism does believe in the concept of an individual judgment that occurs at the bridge of judgment. Each human soul must cross this bridge and face spiritual judgment. Should the soul be worthy of life, it is met by a sweet-smelling maiden who guides onward to paradise, while the wicked soul is met at the bridge by a foul-smelling old hag who guides the soul until it falls off the bridge into the abyss of hell. The Zoroastrian hell is reformative, and the soul does not suffer in eternal damnation. This thought is similar to purgatory. The Zoroastrians also believe that hell contains foul smells and evil food, and their concept of hell is extremely congested, but each soul believes it is in total isolation. The Egyptians did believe in the judgment of the dead, whose heart was weighed against a feather. A myth resembling purgatory did emerge in the last century before Christ. Prior to the development of this myth, Egypt believed only in the just and the damned. There was no third option of purification. But in the first century BC, the myth of Psi Osiris came to the surface. This myth described the underworld journeys of Psi Osiris, who learned that death offers three options, not two. The first path was designed for those whose good actions outweighed the bad, while the second path was for those whose bad actions outweigh the good. And the third option is for those whose actions are balanced between good and bad. This myth also seems to indicate a reversal of fortune. The rich become poor, while the poor become rich. This reversal seems to indicate a judgment process by a deity of some sort. It is interesting to note that this myth is similar to the parable taught by Jesus of the rich man and Lazarus the beggar in the Gospel of Luke. Did the ancient Egyptians believe in the purification of the soul after death? With the noted exception of the myth of Psi Osiris, Egyptian mythology could not be the root of the Roman Catholic concept of purgatory. Among the Greeks, the first recorded instance of the netherworld being the land of shades and ghosts came from Homer's Odyssey in the latter half of the 8th century BC. Through these tales of Homer and the Theogony of Hesiod, we have a clear linkage of Hades with the idea of punishment for our deeds. The Greek philosophers and poets followed the Egyptians in the netherworld, being a place of both rewards and punishments. In the 6th century BC, a secret cult arose around the poems of Orpheus, who insisted that the dead must rid themselves of the evil part of their nature by ritual and moral purification through a series of reincarnations. The devotees of this cult pronounced horrible curses and terrible suffering in the afterlife on those who reject their concept of sacrifice. Some of the initiated believed that it was possible for the living to perform rituals that assisted the souls in the afterlife. This thought is very similar to the Catholic view of purgatory. Some historians believe that Orpheism could be the link between Greek mythology and the doctrine of purgatory. They stress this fact because no evidence of a belief in an intermediate state in the afterlife can be found in ancient Judaism and the early Hebrew Christians. It is suggested that purgatory came from the Christianized Greeks who folded Orphic doctrine into Christianity. The early philosophers, Plato and Adamantus, Plato's brother, rejected the doctrines of Orpheism because it removed personal accountability from the immortal soul for the deeds done while alive. Plato was convinced that sin is an act of free will and hence a matter of individual responsibility. The fate of the soul is not arbitrary, but is dependent on our own choices and the judgment of God. Plato also believed to some extent that the individual soul could develop its own form of incarnation. Plato said, "Yet shall thou pay them the due penalty, either while thou art among us or after thy departure in Hades." Plato also believed in cycles of reincarnation through the principle of metempsychosis as a means to purge the soul and exact divine justice. Metempsychosis is the transmigration of the soul from one body to another, for better or worse. Pindar, a 6th century BC Greek poet, who was also cited by Plato, estimated that purification in the netherworld lasted for 8 years. Could Greek mythology be the pre-Christian link to the doctrine of purgatory? I think yes. The doctrine of purgatory might be more Greek myth than scriptural truth. The early Hebrews had no notion of life after death. To them, Sheol, also known as the pit or the grave, was a dark place from which none returned. The idea of an afterlife in Sheol began to develop during the time of the Jewish prophets. Isaiah was the first prophet who made a distinction between the dead in the netherworld by compartmentalizing Sheol in the levels reserved for the enemies of God. Ezekiel came along after Isaiah and also compartmentalized Sheol. He divided the dead between the circumcised and the uncircumcised, and he also subdivided the dead between those who died by the sword and those who didn't. Ezekiel also wrote that the shame of the dead would follow them into Sheol. In other words, our deeds do follow us, both good and bad, into the afterlife. In verse 23 of the same chapter, Ezekiel seems to divide Sheol into different destinations. He said that the remotest part of Sheol belonged to the enemies of Israel. The idea of an afterlife that included both rewards and punishments was developed by Daniel the prophet, who divided the dead between the righteous and the unrighteous. The righteous would rise and shine as bright as the stars of heaven, while the unrighteous would suffer everlasting contempt. At this point, we can draw a conclusion from silence. The concept of the purging of sin after death cannot be found in the Old Testament. Daniel does include the idea of rewards and punishments in the resurrection at the Last Judgment, but no Hebrew doctrine can be found that justifies the concept of purgatory. There are two possible source references found in the intertestamental literature that might support the Roman Catholic concept of purgatory, and these are the apocryphal Book of Enoch, written around 170 BC, and the Second Book of Maccabees. The Book of Enoch places the righteous and the wicked in different locations in Sheol while awaiting the resurrection and the final judgment. But this is not the most compelling piece of evidence. The most compelling evidence provided by Roman Catholicism for the pre-Christian belief in purgatory comes from the Book of 2 Maccabees. Making a gathering sent 12,000 drachmas of silver to Jerusalem for sacrifice to be offered for the sins of the dead, thinking well and religiously concerning the resurrection. For if he had not hoped that they that were slain should rise again, it would have seemed superfluous and vain to pray for the dead. And because he considered that they who had fallen asleep with godliness had great grace laid up for them, it is therefore a holy and wholesome thought to pray for the dead, that they may be loosed from sins. According to Roman doctrine, this is the first mention of purgatory in the Bible. Why would Roman Catholicism quote from 2 Maccabees when this apocryphal work was clearly rejected by the Council of Carthage in 397 AD when the New Testament canon was finalized? The answer is simple. No other proof could be established. In fact, the Roman Catholic Church did not officially recognize the Apocrypha until the Council of Trent in 1546 AD. It is obvious to most scholars that this citation in 2 Maccabees is a description of the ritual sacrifices for the dead that came from the Greek cult of Orpheus. Again, let me reiterate, the doctrine of purgatory might be more Greek myth than scriptural truth. Purgatory in the New Testament? This is difficult to discuss because, like the Old Testament, the New Testament also does not explicitly mention an intermediate state between heaven and hell. There is no scripture to support this doctrine in the New Testament, but there is one noted exception, and that reference is found in the first epistle to the Corinthians. 4. No one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. If any man builds on this foundation, using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's works. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. Clearly, these verses are describing a purifying process caused by some ethereal flame. But does this reference provide a detailed description of a third option different from heaven or hell? As to how this purification occurs, I will discuss later in this episode. Should this be the only reference in the Bible used as a scriptural foundation for purgatory, then we are in a dangerous place. It is risky to build a major church doctrine on one verse in the Bible. We should look to the whole volume of Scripture to build our foundation of faith. According to Roman Catholic teaching, this is not the only reference that implies a purification process. They insist Jesus taught in Matthew chapter 5, verses 24 through 26, that we owe a debt to God and we will not be allowed in his presence until you have paid the last penny. They insist that the last penny need not be paid in heaven, while no amount of payment can release us from hell. Therefore, a third option must be available, called purgatory. This rationale so undermines the blood sacrifice of Jesus to pay our debt to God that it nullifies the purpose for Calvary. The Catholic Church also uses the descent of Jesus into the prison house of hell to liberate the Old Testament saints as an example that purgatory exists and is a holding place for the saints of God. What else can be said about a doctrine that has no scriptural basis? We have both Old Testament and New Testament teachings on both heaven and hell, but the Bible is silent on the existence of purgatory as taught by Roman Catholicism. It is interesting to note that two Jewish treatises from the period between the destruction of the temple by the Romans and the Bar Kokhba revolt have survived from antiquity. These works show an evolution in Jewish thought concerning the dead and Shiloh. Both treatises document the teachings of Rabbi Shammai, who died around 30 AD, who taught that at the judgment there would be three groups of people, the truly holy, the truly wicked, and a third group being a combination of the two. The truly holy shall live until the end of time, and the truly wicked shall remain in Gehenna. The third group shall go to Gehenna for a time, then come up again. Thus, we see an evolution in Jewish thinking that an intermediate place exists between heaven and hell, and that place is reserved for the less than holy dead, who will be judged for their sins, then allowed to enter Eden. But we do not see the same evolution in apostolic works from the same era. Should both the Old Testament and New Testament be silent about the reality of purgatory, then how did this doctrine come into existence? The history of purgatory has an interesting paradox. The early church fathers who theorized the existence of purgatory were Greek, but the Greek Orthodox Church rejects the concept of purgatory. In fact, the doctrine of purgatory became very divisive between the Greek Church and the Latin Church during the Middle Ages. Clement of Alexandria, in the 2nd century AD, was the first to theorize that the afterlife had two distinct categories of sinners and punishments. Clement perceived that there would be two fires, one fire to devour and consume, while the second fire sanctifies and does not consume. Origen agreed with Clement, his mentor, in regards to the two distinct categories of sinners. Origen also thought that all men, even the righteous, must be purified by fire. He believed that every soul is tainted by its union with the flesh. Origen did not stop with these theories, but he developed the doctrine of universalism, where all creation will eventually be saved. This theory caused Origen to be condemned as a heretic. Even though Clement and Origen subscribed to the purification fires of God's judgment, a separate and distinct place known as purgatory had not developed in the writings of the early church fathers. No other notable change came to the doctrine of purgatory until the end of the 4th century, and that would come from the pen of Augustine of Hippo. He did support some of the teachings of Clement and Origen concerning the purgatorial fires of God's last judgment. But he also added that this purifying fire was imposed between death and the final judgment. 3. Apocryphal works came to light during the anti-Nicene era of the early church. These works were the Apocalypse of Peter, the Apocalypse of Ezra, and the Apocalypse of Paul. These three works had a distinct influence on the development of purgatory between the 6th and the 12th centuries. The first two apocryphal works were in circulation among the early Christian congregations for several centuries. In fact, the Apocalypse of Peter was cataloged among the canonical books by the Roman Church in the 2nd century, but was stricken from the canon by the Council of Carthage in 397 AD. All of these works provided similar vivid descriptions of heaven and hell, but the Apocalypse of Paul was the most significant to the history of purgatory. This work was the first to introduce the distinction between an upper and lower hell, and by the 12th century, this distinction evolved into a place called purgatory. I must stress that Augustine of Hippo hated this work and considered it a foolish flight of fancy. He said, "Some presumptuous men, some very stupid men, have invented the Apocalypse of Paul, which the church rightly does not recognize, and which is full of I know not what fables." The last church father to support the idea of the purging fires of God was Pope Gregory the Great in the last of the 6th century. He provided more detailed observations concerning the afterlife. Even though he spoke extensively on the issues of hell, he made no mention of a specific place called purgatory. Between Gregory the Great and the 12th century, little progress was made on the construction of purgatory. That is nearly 5 centuries. The 12th century was an era of unrest and social change. The social structure of feudal Europe came into focus as a tri-apartite social division. The three classes of society were those who prayed, being the clergy, those who fight, being the lords and knights of feudalism, and those who worked, comprising the lower peasantry class. Clerical documents surviving from this era also show a shift in the doctrine of the purging fires of God. Heaven was viewed as the resting place of the righteous and pure, the saints and the martyrs, who are allowed to see God face to face. Hell seemed to have two possibilities. The first being the consuming fires of the lower pit, reserved for the evil and the wicked, and a higher realm, used by God as a holding tank for the souls awaiting the final judgment and the resurrection. This holding tank was known as Abraham's bosom, noted in the parable of Jesus concerning the evil rich man and the poor beggar named Lazarus. During the 12th century, Abraham's bosom evolved into a place of purification that soon became known as purgatory. Most documents coming out of the monasteries during the 12th century supported the idea that some form of purging was necessary based upon the purifying fires identified in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verses 10 through 15. But this century also added a new element, and that was the idea that the living could pray for the dead and help in their purifying process. This idea was gleaned from 2 Maccabees chapter 12 verse 46. It is therefore a holy and wholesome thought to pray for the dead, that they may be loosed from sin. These two ideas eventually grew together and formed the scriptural basis for the doctrine of purgatory. Before the end of the 12th century, purgatory would exist as a distinct place separate from heaven and hell. The three theologians that most influenced the evolution of purgatory was Hugh of St. Victor, who died in 1141, Bernard of Clairvaux, who died in 1153, and Peter Lombard, who died in 1159. The doctrine of purgatory was formally recognized at the Council of Lyons in 1274. The council wrote, "Those who have died in a state of charity, truly repentant, but before they have brought forth fruit worthy of repentance, their souls are purified after death by cleansing pains. The petitions of the living, the sacrifices of masses, prayers and alms deeds, and other pious services are profitable to them for the lifting of these pains." The final nuances of the doctrine of purgatory were filled in at the Council of Trent in 1545 and again in 1563. We are now back to Martin Luther and his rejection of the third place. He insisted that this invented world had no scriptural foundation in the Bible. But toward the end of his life, he acknowledged that purgatory was a matter of personal opinion. John Calvin, a 16th century theologian, wrote, "Therefore, we must cry out with a shout, not only of our voices, but of our throats and lungs, that purgatory is a deadly fiction of Satan, which nullifies the cross of Christ, inflicts unbearable contempt upon God's mercy, and overturns and destroys our faith. For what means this purgatory of theirs, but that satisfaction for sins is paid by the souls of the dead after they're dead?" By the time of the Reformation, the doctrine of purgatory was twisted to the point that purgatory was a place of penal suffering for the sake of satisfying the demands for justice. This distortion lent itself to gross abuse that was strongly rejected by the reformers, and that abuse was the issuance of papal indulgences. In order to put the Catholic doctrine of papal indulgences into context, we must understand that the Roman papacy dogmatically taught that the Pope is the inheritor of the keys of the kingdom via the Apostle Peter. Rome based this authority on Matthew chapter 16, verses 18 through 19. And I say also unto thee, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom, and whatsoever thou bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever shalt thou loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Catholic doctrine teaches that Peter alone was empowered by Jesus Christ to bind or loose the sins of men. They taught that whatever Peter bound on earth would be bound in heaven, and whatever he forgave on earth would be forgiven in heaven. The Roman papacy made a bold leap when they claimed the same authority as a right of succession. They teach that Peter was the first pope of Rome, and the Roman bishop inherited the keys to the kingdom from Peter. Roman Catholic doctrine also taught that the Roman pope and his successors have the authority and power to bind men to their sins or forgive them. The doctrine also teaches that a great treasury of merit exists that stockpiles the surplus good works of Christ and the saints, and these merits may be drawn upon by the Pope to increase the merit of other Christians through indulgences. We are now at the root of the papal indulgence issue. First years of the second millennium, the Roman papacy saw that this assumed authority could be a profitable cash cow. The earliest record of a papal plenary indulgence was the declaration by Pope Urban II at the Council of Clermont in 1095. Pope Urban said that he would remit all penance incurred by crusaders who confessed their sins and participated in his crusade to the Holy Land. The door of greed flew open and the cash started to flow. Rome would be rich. The opulent wealth of Rome, generated by the sale of indulgences, infuriated John Huss and John Wycliffe. John Wycliffe wrote, "There is no greater heresy for a man than to believe that he is absolved from sin if he gives money, or because a priest lays his hand on his head and says, 'I absolve you,' for you must be sorrowful in your heart, else God does not absolve you. I confess that the indulgences of the Pope, if they are what they are pretended to be, are a manifest blasphemy, inasmuch as he claims a power to save men almost without limit, and not only to mitigate the penalties of those who have sinned by granting them the aid of absolutions and indulgences, that they should never come to purgatory, but to give command to the holy angels that, when the soul is separated from the body, they may carry it without delay to everlasting rest. Will then a man shrink from acts of licentiousness and fraud if he believes that soon after, by the aid of a little money bestowed on friars, an active absolution from the crime he has committed may be obtained?" The power of indulgence grew out of the Roman Catholic doctrine of purgatory. The more purgatory became a third place other than heaven or hell, the more the sale of indulgences grew in influence. In the early 16th century, the papacy was seriously corrupted with greed, avarice, and sexual immorality. Pope Leo X of the Medici family sold church offices and bishoprics to his favorite relatives. He also tapped the Vatican treasury to support his extravagant lifestyle. He needed large sums of money to complete construction on St. Peter's Cathedral in Rome, begun by Pope Julius II. When the money ran out, Pope Leo X instituted a fundraising scheme of selling forgiveness. For a fee, a relative could get a deceased loved one out of purgatory. These indulgences could also be saved up for future sins. Pope Leo authorizes sale of indulgences in Germany, with half the proceeds going to Jacob Fugger, an Austrian merchant, and half going to Rome to fund the building of his basilica. The unrestricted sale of indulgences began, and professional pardoners were sent throughout Europe to collect the contributions. Some of the promises preached by these hucksters went way beyond the basic doctrine of purgatory to a doctrine that the damned in hell could be released through the purchase of a papal indulgence. Among these pardoners was a Dominican monk named John Tetzel, who was commissioned to sell German indulgences, and he traveled through towns and villages with his famous slogan, "As soon as the coin in the coffer rings, the soul from purgatory springs." Many Germans were offended with Tetzel's tactics, and chief among them was a priest by the name of Martin Luther. On October 31st of 1517, Luther posted his famous 95 Theses on a church bulletin board in Wittenberg, Germany. Luther wanted to bring to light the apparent corruption of papal Rome and the sale of indulgences. Luther's idea was to have a debate in a public forum to vocalize his concerns. Luther challenged the authority of the Pope to forgive sin. In Theses 82, he wrote, "Why does not the Pope empty purgatory for the sake of holy love? For after all, he does release countless souls for the sake of sordid money contributed for the building of a cathedral." Luther challenged his readers to set their trust on entering heaven through faith in Jesus Christ rather than false security and peace offered by papal indulgence. Shortly after this event, a copy found its way to a person who had a printing press. Luther's debate never occurred because his theses were translated into German, printed and circulated throughout Europe within 2 months, and these copies propelled him into a massive Reformation controversy. Martin Luther only wanted a debate, but God wanted Reformation. What was the formal reaction of the Roman Church to Luther and the Reformation? Pope Paul III convened the Council of Trent in 1545. This council ratified the doctrines of purgatory and indulgence, and they canonized 7 books of the Apocrypha and added them to the Bible. This action was done in order to provide legal scriptural proof for these pet doctrines. Now, purgatory and indulgences are linked by papal decree. One would think that all the chaos generated by the Reformation over the doctrines of papal indulgences and purgatory would cause the Roman Church to reevaluate their theology concerning these issues, but it did not. Indulgences are still being granted today by the Pope, with the last major indulgence issued by the Vatican being the Jubilee Indulgence of 2000. The sad truth? No scripture can be found to support the existence of this realm of spirit. Simply stated, the doctrine of purgatory dogmatically teaches that heaven is earned by personal merit, not the mercy of God found in the blood of Jesus. Should we accept the existence of purgatory, then we must believe that Christ's blood sacrifice is insufficient to save humanity, and we must give God a helping hand by working to earn our salvation. We also must accept that the blood of Jesus Christ has only limited power to save and purify his flock, and a subsequent work of purification is necessary after death to prepare the soul for the purity of heaven. We understand from the book of Hebrews that we are destined to die only once, then face the judgment of God. What if this judgment involves passing through the veil of Christ into the heavenly kingdom? The author of Hebrews also taught that the path into the holy presence of God is open by the blood of Jesus. We must pass through the veil of Christ before we can enter heaven. Let's read. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. While in this veil we endure our own personal judgment and purification. Paul, in his epistle to the Corinthians, wanted his readers to understand that our works will be tried by fire as a test of each man's personal life. The personal judgment described by Paul is clearly a refinement process in preparation for entering his eternal presence. When do we think this sanctification process happens? Do we think God allows us to enter heaven unchanged? Do we think God allows us into heaven, but at the last judgment we leave heaven to endure the purification of our works by fire? This is not logical. The mercy of God would not allow such a thing. Our personal judgment must occur as we pass through the veil of Christ. I have often wondered where this purifying fire comes from. I have concluded that it must come from the eyes of our glorified Jesus. As we enter the veil of Christ, we must gaze into His glorified eyes that are filled with blazing fire. Our works are tried by fire when we embrace the gaze of Jesus in love. At this time, our true selves are exposed, and our religious exterior is burnt away. Paul made it clear that all are saved, but all do not receive the same rewards. How long does this process take in human terms? I don't know. It is possible that the basic concept of purgatory is a description of our personal judgment and sanctification as we pass through the veil of Christ into the heavenly kingdom of God. Do we think sanctification stops once we die? Or do we continually grow in sanctification and holiness while in heaven? Just remember, without holiness, no one will see the Lord.